One of our goals as seismologists is to characterize earthquake hazards. To do this, we make simulations of expected ground shaking for various earthquake magnitudes. In order to make these simulations, we need to know a few things about the earthquake and the surrounding geology. We need to know the location of the earthquake, its magnitude, the length of the rupture, and the distribution of slip along the fault. The model must also take into account how the earthquake waves move through the 3D geological structure in the area. Once we have an educated understanding of these parameters, we form a model and run it through a supercomputer. Let's look at one of these simulations, which the U.S. Geological Survey prepared for a magnitude 7 earthquake on the Hayward Fault. The Hayward Fault is 50 miles long, extending from San Pablo Bay in the northwest down to Fremont in the southeast. The earthquake in this simulation will originate beneath San Pablo Bay. To help orient you, we're looking at the ground movement of the bay from a vantage point over the Oakland Airport. The ground movement you see is exaggerated 1,000 times to clearly show the shaking. The color scale at the top right corner indicates the intensity of the shaking. For example, an intensity of 5 would generate strong shaking and be strongly felt by people, but have minimal impact on structures. An intensity of 9 would create truly intense ground motions that could affect and damage engineered structures. As the simulated rupture begins, a red circle shows the epicenter of the earthquake. About 4 or 5 seconds after the earthquake begins, or nucleates, the waves reach the surface of the Earth. As one might expect, as the earthquake's energy propagates, the ground's surface will distort. The blue halo is the P wave that travels at about 13,000 miles an hour, and the warmer colors show the slower S waves and other more intense seismic energy. The crust fractures along the fault as the seismic energy travels from the epicenter towards the south at a speed of about 7,000 miles an hour. Looking closely, you can see a rolling motion coming through. This is one of two surface wave types known as a Rayleigh wave. The second type of surface wave, which you can see has a back and forth type of motion, is the Love wave. Because of the geological structure of the East Bay, the ground motions are not uniform along the fault. Much larger motions to the east are due to the lower seismic wave speeds and the geologic materials there. Notice that as the rupture continues to travel southward on the Hayward Fault, the seismic waves pile up and the ground motions amplify greatly. We call this directivity. Creating accurate earthquake simulations to increase our understanding of what the shaking will be for a major earthquake is one of the many challenges seismologists and earthquake engineers face. To validate our models, we test them by running simulations of smaller, more common earthquakes that have happened and compare the results to the real observed shaking distributions of these earthquakes. The more accurate our models are, the better we understand the process, and the more effectively we might be able to mitigate the effects. By studying and refining our models, we gain a better understanding of the physics of earthquakes and how they can impact our livelihoods. Scientists and engineers understand that no model is 100% correct, but we don't need the model to be 100% correct in order to estimate ground shaking and the possible effects a large rupture can have on an area. Over time, these models shape hazard mitigation strategies and help us become better prepared for the next big quake.